So, JP, thank you so much for coming on the show today, man.
You're welcome, Justin. I'm happy to be here with you in the absence of Zach.
Yeah,
he's pretending he has more important things to do, but the joke's on him because we know this is the most important thing to do in the moment. But yeah, so pleased that you invited me on.
No, absolutely. You know, and we were talking before we started the whole interview, and I had mentioned to you that I saw one of your videos and was rolling on the floor laughing, and you know, continued to absorb some of your content that you put out in the world. And I more recently found out that this is actually, you know, something that you've been doing for a very long time in the spiritual coaching world and all that good stuff. So why don't you tell our audience kind of how you got to this point?
Yeah, so this point of being a delusional redhead with blue eyes, so pinnacle of my life.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, you know, this, I think some of this point is I've had the good fortune of becoming known for my comedy, comedy videos, book, stage performances. But as you alluded to, there's a big background I had, and still have actually, hasn't gone anywhere before this, where for the past 15 years, I've been an emotional healing coach where I'm working with people to help them help themselves, heal their hearts, grow into their authenticity and step into their personal power. And I've had the chance to teach lots of retreats, workshops, classes around the world. And so there's two principal parts of me, at least professionally, the sincere part and the satirical comedy part. And those two parts help make the whole of me. I think there's other parts, but they're both really important. And then it just maybe worth mentioning in my story of where I'm at now is about two and a half years ago, I decided to start sharing my perspective through the language of humor as an additional sort of like octave of my voice. And, having a sense of humor, kind of like a pretty dominant comedic part, that's something I've had my whole life. But for a long time, I just told myself, well, it'd be terrible for business to let that come out. You know, I won't look like a real, you know, emotional healing, spiritual guy. So I just got tired of betraying myself. And I'm like, yeah, no, my sense of humor is welcome here too. And it's weird how well it's worked for me. Like if I didn't know any better, I would dare say allowing me to be me works really well for me. Vitamin A, vitamin authenticity, I think.
I love it. So, you know, we live in a world now where, you know, we talk a lot about how men need to be strong and masculine and not that we don't really kind of go into the meditation spiritual world all so much. I mean, obviously a lot of men do, but it's not something that's really open and adopted by everybody. Have you found that using the comedy to kind of teach your the things that you've learned through your life has opened up a lot of men to the idea of it? And was that the goal?
Yeah, great questions. Yeah, by the way, real men don't cry. They spend their weekends chopping wood. They drive a truck and they make women cook food. Like that's
yeah, right.
Makes me want to throw up in my mouth. But yeah, to me, the medicine we need to take in is usually the medicine we want the least. And I'm not talking about pharmaceuticals. We probably do way too much of that. But the medicine as far as things we need to hear. What a person needs to hear is usually not what they want to hear. Because what we need to hear, I think, usually facilitates change. And I think the human being, our organisms, probably many species, we're just oriented where nature wants us to grow and expand, which in other words means always changing. And change is scary, change is uncomfortable. So when we need to hear something so that we can let go of an old belief, an old feeling, an old sense of self, it means that we're going to get scared. Things are going to change if we actually hear the message that we're needing. So we typically have defense mechanisms. So with humor, I find humor is a very non-threatening language where if I communicate a language in humor versus sincerity, the sincere language, usually defense mechanisms are going to come up, which it doesn't necessarily mean someone's going to be arguing with me, but it can just mean someone's a little bit more dissociated and maybe listening with their head but not hearing with their heart, not allowing themselves to truly consider and contemplate the message. But with humor, the what I would almost call like the vibration of humor, it's non-threatening. Like, it doesn't look like there's anything to defend against, ironically, because there's not anything to defend against. There's nothing to defend against with a sincere message either, but it looks like there's something to defend against, even though there isn't. So with humor, I find that when there's a deeper message embedded in the language of humor, it allows the message to go in deeper, not for the sake of brainwashing anybody, but for the sake of someone using their own sophisticated heart and mind to actually consider something new. To me, that's where the real magic happens. Someone allowing themselves to consider something new. And honestly, like, this is not a flattering analogy, but I think it's an accurate analogy. I'm looking at my dog right now. So if I need to give my dog medication, if I just give him the pill, like, he'll spit it out. He just won't eat it.
Right.
But if I put the pill in a piece of cheese, he swallows it. It goes in. So to me, the humor is the appetizing wrapping around something that's more meaningful.
No,
and with this, go ahead.
I was just gonna say that's a perfect analogy. I mean, you know, it's because, like you said, we live in this world now where everybody just wants to numb everything. We want to numb the bad that we want to numb all the bad things that are going on in our lives. And if you're able to kind of make it an easier process, then they're willing to kind of open up and then get into that uncomfortable zone.
For sure. And I also realize in that analogy, I've analogized my whole audience to dogs. But I love dogs. Like, dogs are awesome. Dogs,
who doesn't love dogs?
Sweeter than people. There's a reason why dog is God's spelled backwards. And the other part of your question, you know, helping men open up. Like, I do think the strategy of having one of the octaves of my voice and humor does help men and women, but men in this case, because we're talking about men, so we can be so ungender fluid.
Yeah, right.
It does help men open up. And I think, you know, one of there's oftentimes, you know, the challenges that women face, adversity, those get talked about. But the challenges that men face, I think, are underappreciated. And I think some of the archetypal challenges that we as men face is we're supposed to be strong and stable. And what that means, in other words, is we're supposed to be resistant to change. And I think that's the worst thing for us. Yet sometimes we're taught, like, a real man is, you know, strong, stable. He knows what he thinks and, like, doesn't let it change. And a real man isn't supposed to have emotions, not supposed to be vulnerable. God forbid, Christ. So being able to open up sort of like the inner realities of humankind with a scalpel of humor to expose, like, hey, we all have this, and it's okay if you do too. Being able to do that with a scalpel of humor, I think, has been helpful. I never really planned on having that be a consequence of the comedy, especially just with men specifically.
Sure.
But like, I've sort of like grown into realizing why I do what I do with comedy, where in the beginning I by no means had any premeditated notion of what's the kind of like the self-empowerment or even the magical part of my comedy. It's like, oh, I'm just the blind man stumbling along, not premeditating it. But in hindsight, I can see, like, oh, that's what it does, and that seems to work pretty well. So I'm not intelligent enough to engineer it, but I guess I'm intelligent enough to observe it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And apparently intelligent enough to execute it too.
Yeah, and I mean, and that's the perfect example too of, like, sometimes you just have to take action in your life and see what happens, you know?
For sure. I think oftentimes we get caught up on the how, the why and the how, but I think, taking action, like the child doesn't wait to learn to walk until it knows how or until it knows why. No, it takes the action.
Right.
And later on, it discovers like, oh, that's how I did it. And here's why I walk. Like I can grow up and run around on the playground and then just have an easier life because I'm able to use my legs in a bipedal fashion.
Sure. No, absolutely. And so obviously you weren't a 4-year-old redheaded kid, doing yoga and meditation. What was the introduction? How did you stumble upon this journey?
Yeah, that would be funny to be a 4-year-old redheaded. Like, I'm committed to yoga.
By the way, I expect this to be in one of your videos.
I think.
4-year-old kid with the long red hair with the bandana on and just doing some yoga.
I think that'd be good. So, when I was 20, I got really interested in the mystery of life that's beyond what our five senses comprehend. Like, I was just. Like, felt empty and hollow enough inside. It's like pain's the best motivator. So I was hollow enough inside to be motivated to look for something solid, something more meaningful than the idea of like work, earn money, and for what? Was it like a great question I didn't have the answer to, but for what was an important motivation to look for something that I didn't know how to find, look for something, even though I didn't know what that something was. But it's just like the search, kind of like the hero's journey. Here's the call to quest. Doesn't know what the hell he's questing for or what she's questing for, but goes out on the journey. So I started searching for something more meaningful, and that led me to get interested in emotions, spirituality, and like, wow, let's solve it. A year ago, I would have called it all this stuff crap, but like I'm interested and I feel like actually I feel better inside of myself learning
Sure.
about the human psyche. And then when I was 23, that journey continued. And then when I was 23, a mentor of mine who I had been studying with for about 3 years at that point has a health institute in San Diego, California. It was North County, San Diego, to be specific, and he asked me if I'd be willing to move out there from Ohio, where I was born and raised, and start running my client practice out of his facility and start training to teach his courses. And it's a great opportunity, scared the hell out of me, so I said yes. And during that time, I moved out there when I was 23, and that was an immersion into quite a yogic world, quite a world that I would later learn to call the ultra spiritual world. So, one of the towns that I hung out in all the time, Encinitas, I've been told that it has more yoga studios per capital than or per capita than anywhere else in the country. I don't know if that's true, but it's definitely true that I've been told that. So, nonetheless, it was in like self-realization fellowship meditation gardens. So, a lot of spiritual-minded, yogi, new age, health-conscious people,
Sure.
and with that comes the shadow side. There comes the egotistical agendas that aren't spoken about. We act like they're not there, and we definitely think they're not there, and they're very obvious that they're there. So it took me a number of years of kind of like bumping into that kind of thing and me living it too, not
Sure.
just in other people, before I could like recognize like, oh yeah, apparently there is a shadow side to everything. Apparently, the
Absolutely.
path that one takes to find themselves can also be the path that they lose themselves on. So I think that's when the 4-year-old yogi inside of me was born.
Nice. No, I really like that. And it's so true in the path of trying to find yourself, you can certainly lose yourself depending on what it is. I mean, you see it all the time. If you look at a young college kid coming out of college, going into the corporate world and he's trying to find himself and what he's supposed to do, and he's just chasing money and he's chasing all those things and same kind of deal that other people may be able to relate to from that standpoint. You go in with good intentions, and you don't always come out with good intentions. So that's obviously very interesting. And then obviously, you know, the path kind of goes from there. When did you start doing the videos, and what was that moment like when you put it out there? Because I think there's a lot of fear in putting yourself out there. Like, I know when we started this podcast, actually coming up on a year ago, it was intimidating to say, hey, we're doing this. So what was that feeling, and what pushed you over the edge to really put it out there?
Yeah, so October 4th, 2014 was the first comedy video that I put out. And for a year and a half before that, I had been doing YouTube videos, sincere life advice videos. So being on camera was relatively easy. Putting myself out there was easy, but this was a new thing.
Yeah.
It was the idea of like, wow, I'm making a comedy video and I'm going to publish that. Like, one, I think that'll be bad for business. Two, I don't know that it'll be funny to anybody. Like, I think it's funny. And three, like, yeah, like, will I be laughed at, ridiculed? Like, so there was definitely that moment. There was a lot of fear, honestly. It was very intimidating. And because it was putting myself out in a very new way. It was definitely doing something very new. And also, there was a lot of vulnerability in it, because I'm taking a part of me that is very much me, the comedic, satirical aspect of me, and I'm exposing it. Like, that part of me typically gets covered up, and, you know, friends know it's there. If someone were taking like a weekend workshop with me, they'd learn of it. But like, this was just a much more of a public whipping open the jacket and showing I had nothing on underneath. And yeah, so it felt very insecure, and also felt very empowering that I clicked upload anyway. And the video had been published for at least a week before it started to take off. And during that week, I got over like the fears and anxiety. It's funny, like, how for me, at least, when I jump off the cliff, the moment I leave the ledge is typically when I feel better.
Right.
I think it's the resistance that creates so much fear and anxiety, because the thing we're going to do is still a mystery to us. But when we jump off, so when I clicked the upload button, that was big, especially after a day or two goes by. It's like, okay, nobody's messaged me to tell me I'm wrong for being alive, at least nobody that I cared about.
Right.
And then, you know, about a week later, I'm like, I saw like all of a sudden, like, wow, this video has over 1,000 views, which at the time I was like, wow.
Right.
You know, in the year and a half before this, I've only had one video reach 1,000 views, and this one's done in a week. What?
That's awesome.
Just so amazing. And then someone actually kind of pirated it off my YouTube channel, uploaded it to their Facebook. A couple people did that, and both started racking up the views, got over 1 million views on their accounts pretty quickly. And that was really exciting to see. So like, it was just sort of like a confusing time in a good way after the initial fear, resistance, self-doubt, self-criticism happened, which honestly, all of that launched me into even a more insecure time, because it was a time of change. Like, I had the urge, like, oh, there's more depth to this. Well, like, I could keep making comedy videos, even though I didn't really plan on that. But like, I could keep doing this. But like, what's my rhythm? How do I mix this with the sincere work I'm doing? But I knew I had to figure it out. I knew I had to do it. So, but not knowing how to kind of like give birth to this new identity of myself, at least at a professional level, was a very insecure feeling.
I bet. Now, how much of that dark side that you saw, or the shadow side that you saw in San Diego in these videos, out of curiosity?
So much, so much. And I also like to say the videos are my therapy as well. I like to use the videos, like whatever the video topic is, it's typically something directly in my life, maybe indirectly, but somehow it's in my life. So it's a way that I get to shine the light on my shadow, shine the light on a practice, a philosophy where I typically hide. I typically hide behind some altruistic, noble looking practice or philosophy, but I have junk there. I have judgments. I have intolerances. I have narcissism. I have egotistical desires to be significant. So I like to shine the light on that. And with that, yes, a lot of living in Southern California was great inspiration. Like, wow, I see people do this kind of stuff all the time, like competitive consciousness and, you know, who's more gluten intolerant than the other.
Which is crazy. The fact that that's a real thing, that's crazy. So you talk, you know, obviously with your coaching clients, you do a lot of like emotional healing. And I truly believe that everybody carries baggage with them that needs to be cleared out in some way or dealt with. And a lot of times we just bury it and it comes out in different acts of our lives. Like I have a ton from my childhood and a lot of people don't even realize it until it becomes uncovered. We always like to give tips during these interviews for people that are listening, something they can do to grow in their life since we're called the Growth Now Movement. What's something a listener can do that they realize, maybe they don't realize what it is that's holding them back or creating the issues in their life. What's something they can do to kind of bring it out and start the healing process a little bit?
It would, two things. The first step for me is get freaking in touch with your feelings. And I'm talking about real primal feelings, not like abstract, well, I feel my sister got more attention. Like that's not a feeling. That's a story that we call a feeling.
Right.
But like feelings and not even like what we would call emotions. We want to get more primal, more cellular, more intimate than that. So I'm talking about feelings in the sense of sensations. So I love to invite people to take a couple minutes first thing in the morning. You're sitting up, find the dominant sensation in your body. Something that it takes no more than 8 IQ points to describe, like tingling, tightness in my abdomen, burning in my throat, fluttering in my stomach. So very, very primal sensations, and feel those. Feel them, not trying to change them, just trying to feel the feelings that are there. We all know that if you use a muscle more, it gets stronger. If you use a muscle less, it gets weaker and it can atrophy. That muscle can actually start to disappear. And for the most part, especially men, but I'll throw women under the bus too, gender equality. Women too, you're screwed up. We have, on the whole, very weak feeling muscles, meaning we have very little capacity to sense and feel what we're actually feeling. So much like any muscle, it won't get stronger unless we train it. So for me, a deliberate practice of feeling feelings, even just a couple minutes, and we're not trying to do anything fancy. We're just trying to feel our feelings, strengthening our ability to feel. So important.
Yeah.
Step number two would be mention feelings to people that you would otherwise conceal. And I'm not saying blame them. And I'm not even saying give them an elaborate story. I think when we have a story surrounding feelings, the story is typically a membrane used to try to disconnect from the feeling. Let me mention the feeling and then I'll talk about the feeling for 2 seconds and then a 2-hour story. You get, it's yeah. Just like I'll mention the story, the feeling, so I have an excuse for 2 hours worth of disconnection from that feeling. Yikes. So, for example, for me, a big one is anger. It is very easy for me to swallow my anger, get emotionally constipated, because I have this, part of me has this belief that says, if I'm angry, I'm not lovable. If I have this very natural human emotion, healthy emotion called anger, I'm not lovable. People won't like me. They'll leave me. And it really costs me when I disconnect from my anger. I keep it buried inside so much so that it's numb and I don't even feel it. So one of my current challenges is let people know either when I'm angry, preferably when I'm angry, or second best is after the fact. Like, you know, yesterday when we talked, I mentioned at the time, I was too scared to, honestly, but I felt angry. Or happy or sad, but anger is just my example that I struggle with. So
right.
Talking about feelings we typically conceal, to me, is powerful action step number two. All of that's simple, and I think the power of anything is found in the simplicity.
Yeah, that's so key. I mean, communication and talking about how you're feeling is super important. And actually, I had mentioned to you that I have a coach that kind of walks me through a lot of this stuff, and she truly taught me that it's okay to be angry. Like, you have just as the same right to be angry as you do sad.
Yeah, so weird.
You know, it's okay. Yeah, like, oh, wow. You know what I mean? But, like, it's so funny that I needed somebody to tell me that for that to click. So I can fully relate to what you're saying, for sure.
Yeah. Nobody has ever said, like, yeah, your human heart makes anger for a reason.
Yeah,
it doesn't do it because it's evil and has some kind of self-destruct mechanism. It's just like the rainbow doesn't accidentally have colors in it. Each color is there for a purpose. And I think the same thing with our emotional color spectrum inside. Justin, I'm angry at you.
I'm glad you told me. I mean, I'm
not, but
that.
I wish I was so that I could actually like tell you.
Yeah,
you
know? Right. You'd feel better.
I'd like to give you the gift of me being angry at you.
well, we still have some more things to go over, so you might get angry. Who knows? So maybe we'll get there.
I'm offended already. How dare you not ask me what you haven't asked me yet?
Yeah, I know, right? So we talked before, and I had mentioned that we have a mutual friend, and you can correct me about his last name, but Jordan Bowditch.
Yeah, I call him Bowditch, but all we need to know is we love Jordan. He's awesome.
Super amazing guy. He's doing some great stuff, you know, for the world. So I think it's really neat. But he had a question for you. And I have no idea what it means. And he said it might start some good conversation or he might not have an answer. I don't know.
I'm worried already. Justin, I feel afraid.
Yeah, you should. I just don't even know what it is. But the question is, how do you manage to stay strong like Ja?
It's a good question. Strong like Ja. That's definitely from Jordan. I love it. Yeah, I think by saying Ja often, anytime I get excited, instead of saying yeah or good job, I say Ja. So that's how you stay strong like Ja.
Interesting. I like it.
And a little inside story. A mutual friend of Jordan and I's, he's a freaking talented musician named Dustin Thomas. He's got a song called Strong Like Ja. And also Dustin, Jordan and I met Dustin in Kauai at New Year's 2016. That's when I met Jordan. And so Dustin was there, and like anytime someone would say something profound, Dustin would just yell out Ja. And then he has a song, Strong Like Ja. So I think it's like out of fondness of our friend Dustin, as well as it's just freaking funny.
It is funny.
We amuse each other by yelling out Ja often. So the doctrine of how to be strong like Ja.
Yeah, right. You have to. I like it a lot. Actually, it's different. It's something that stands out for sure. If you're just gonna scream Ja for any reason, no matter what it is, just scream Ja. It's good. I like it. But that kind of takes us to what you're working on now, and you just wrote a book for the world to gaze upon. And it's obviously called How to Be Ultra Spiritual. What's it about? Tell us about it. How do people get it? What's all that good stuff?
Yes, the book is available really anywhere you get books, Amazon, Barnes & Noble. Also, you can go to howtobeultraspiritual.com to grab a copy or 100 copies, whatever you'd like. And the book, it's completely written through my comedic character's perspective. It's a comedic take on New Age culture, spiritual culture, health culture, all lumped into one. And so there's a couple of things that I intend for people to take away. One is entertainment and laughing. I don't think anybody's ever said, like, my doctor told me to laugh less. I think it's something we all need more of.
Yeah.
And then there's also deeper messages intended to be there, as we were alluding to with my video work earlier. And a couple of the deeper messages of this book that I intend for the comedy to deliver is, one, the message, let go of that which served you, that no longer serves you. Recognize it, and then I encourage you to let it go. The one of the other messages for me that's an undercurrent of the book is unapologetically be true to yourself and step deeper into your authenticity. Mm. So those are a couple important messages that I think we can never hear too much of. Or too often, and I'm very pleased. I put my heart and soul in this book, so it's a great honor for me to be able to use my comedic voice to deliver entertainment with a message that is at least meaningful to me.
Awesome. I love that. And, you know, obviously, we talk to a lot of successful people on this show, and I'm really big into, like, what kind of routines do people have? What, you know, what kind of grounds them or kind of keeps them moving every single day? Because the more successful you get, the busier you get, and the more you have on your plate and everything like that. So what are three things you do every day to ensure your success?
Yeah, first thing is I wake up and check Facebook for an hour and a half. Second thing I do is turn on the news and find at least three things to get offended about. Third thing is I go yell at my neighbor for doing something wrong. And then the fourth of the three things is I have a beautiful breakfast of processed carbohydrates.
Perfect.
Low fat, low protein, low nutrition. Bro, it's how
that's just how I start every single day. That's just the beginning.
Yeah, otherwise I'm too good. I need to have a governor on myself. Yeah, you know, my routines are actually incredibly important for me. I think a routine creates freedom. It creates a platform of structure and stability, a high platform to launch off of. It's not, to me, like a 24-hour routine. Okay, that's imprisonment. But a routine, you know, similar, like, you know how our childhood, they call them the formative years? Mm-hmm. Because what happens early in our life, it has a powerful influence throughout the rest of our life. Like 80 years old, 90 years old, people are still doing things for the better or worse as a consequence of what happened in their childhood. So in the morning, that's the formative part of our day. That's the childhood of our day. So what's happening in the evening of our day, I think, is not completely determined, but it's strongly influenced by the formative part of our day. So for me, my morning routine is very important to me. I started off by taking a cold shower, usually 30 seconds to a minute long, and it's cold enough that I scream. In the summertime, I live in Charleston, South Carolina, and no matter how cold I turn the shower on, it's just not cold enough to get like a physiological or psychological effect. So I have a big chest freezer that goes on my back deck filled with water. Usually I have to break a layer of ice off of it in the morning. So I get into water that's somewhere between 32 and 40 degrees.
Wow.
Sit in that for a minute. Ooh, gets me going.
It's crazy.
I love it. I used to hate cold water until I did it consistently enough to say, like, I feel enhanced. I love what this does to me. I don't necessarily like the feel of the cold water, but I love what it does. It's a practice of embracing discomfort. And I think that is, man, if we can embrace discomfort in our life, learn to say yes to the things we would otherwise say no to because they're uncomfortable, then I guarantee that success is coming our way. So for me, a cold shower, amongst other things, it's a ritual of saying yes to discomfort. So it's like training that muscle so that that muscle can be used in the field of play elsewhere in our life where it really matters. It's like, now I have a propensity to lean towards that which intimidates me,
right,
instead of leaning away. So cold shower.
Of that explanation, I'm doing that tomorrow morning, and then we'll make it a routine. I loved how you explained it and the reasoning behind it, so I'm going to do it. Because I've heard so many times people talk about cold showers, and I'm like, meh. But how you described it, I'm gonna give it a whirl.
Warm shower sounds better. That sounds awesome. And I would definitely invite you, Justin, and anybody listening, to, if you want to try it, commit to it for a week. And like after 7 days, if it doesn't work for you, like screw it, throw it away. But it's just like exercise for one day. Like you won't see results from one day, but right. You might a cold shower. But I do like to kind of like chunk the time. Try a week, let it have a little bit of a carryover effect. And then so after my cold shower, then I do gratitude journaling. It's pretty short and sweet. I write down three things that I'm grateful for. Then I take a minute with each of those three things and feel the sensations of the gratitude. So it's not just a mental thing like I think I'm grateful for this, but I actually feel the feelings of gratitude. I think our feelings are generated by our hearts. So it's a powerful way to get more heart-centered and connected in the early part of the day. And then I write down three things that I'm excited about, things that I'm like in the process of creating projects. And I write them down as though they're done. Then I feel the excitement that I can conjure up around those. Before the gratitude journaling, I meditate for 10 minutes.
Okay.
Forgot that. Apparently I'm not meditative enough to remember the freaking sequence of this routine I've done a million times. So meditate, gratitude journaling, creative excitement, three things journaling. And then I take a walk for about 30 minutes. And usually I'm listening to a podcast or something like that when I'm walking. And then I come back inside and make bulletproof coffee. And so that whole routine, it's altogether probably – I guess an hour to an hour 15. And I'm really big on not letting routines get so darn long that
right. It's
like, wow, now I'm less productive because I'm doing 9 hours of prep work to be more productive. But I used to do less, but I just find like this is the sweet spot for me. This quantity helps me have a much higher quality day.
Yeah, no, definitely. That's perfect. And you know, I love all that. I do the gratitude journal. I do the meditation in the morning. I'm still learning meditation. I'm not the best at it. I do a couple of guided meditations by a guy named Philip Shepherd that I really like. So I'm better with the guided meditation than just on my own. Because if I do it on my own, I'm way out in outer space. I don't even know what's going on. So it's good. It's good to have the guided and the purpose behind it. So it makes it a little bit better for me. But yeah, that's an amazing morning routine, and I can definitely see why it kind of kicks you into the next level, which is perfect. Now, obviously, like I told you, we wrap up all these interviews in a similar way. I keep saying we, but Zach, did you want to say anything or? No,
he's been so passive during this whole conversation. I think he's just intimidated by the collective handsomeness of you and I, Justin.
It's what it is. It's exactly what it is. but like I said, we wrap up all these in a similar way. So we'll do like a word association game, and then we do five rapid fire questions. But before we get there, is there anything else you want to add? And then again, why don't you tell everybody where to get your book and where to connect with you online?
Sure. One other thing I'll add, for me, an important part of my morning routine is what I don't do. I don't check Facebook. I don't react to text messages. And I've heard a number of other people talk about this. And once I like, well, that makes sense. And I test drove it. It's like, I'm going to keep this practice because it really works for me. If we start off looking at Facebook or responding to emails or responding to text messages before we've centered in ourselves for the day, we're in a reactive state. we are literally reacting to the outside world, which means we're not in our power. We're letting essentially someone else's agenda have power over us. And when we're in a reactive state, we're actually in a relatively stressed, kind of fearful state. But if we can be in a responsive state, meaning, okay, I'm getting to these messages on my terms, and my terms have it, that I'm going to get centered in me, I'm going to connect to me, I'm going to feel good in me, then I'll get to these messages. I think Tony Robbins has a wonderful quote. It's a little bit of a little dramatic, but I think it's awesome. He says, losers react, winners anticipate, something like that. So for me, we do lose when we react, especially when we start our day just reacting. It's like, wow, the purpose of our life is for us to live it, not for us to live other people's agendas. So what we do in the early part of the day, I think, teaches us a lot about how to be. So not being reactive in the first hour or so of the day, it feels so much more peaceful to me. I feel like I have much more of me for the rest of the day. And then just as you so graciously offered again, people can grab my book or avoid it. A better place to get it or avoid it at is howtobeultraspiritual.com or Amazon. And really, I truly would be grateful for anyone who's inspired to grab a copy. Again, put my heart and soul into this creative work.
I also saw on your website that you're kind of doing a little traveling as well to do like book signings and all that stuff as well.
Yeah. I'll be having fun with that. I'll be in Boulder, Colorado, New York, Vancouver, Portland, a couple things in Los Angeles, San Diego, probably other places too. But those are the ones I can remember.
Awesome. Well, hopefully people can kind of catch you out there while you're doing your thing. So now that we've kind of wrapped up everything, are you ready for some word association? So I'll just give you a word. Tell me the first one that comes to mind.
The first word that comes to my mind here in
yes.
your word?
Yes.
Wonderful. I am excited to hear what surprising things are going to be said.
First one, spirituality.
Connection.
Yoga.
Downward dog.
Meditation.
Stillness.
Beef.
Yeah, grass-fed is what came to my mind.
Nice. Love it. So now we'll go into the rapid fire. Just five questions. Some are fun, some are serious, but we ask you this. Only answer within one word or at the most one sentence.
Ooh, the creative constraints.
Yeah, right.
We'll see what kind of juice this squeezes out of us.
Now the last one, you can kind of go on for a little bit, but we, you know, try and keep the other one short. So the first one is, what's the best advice you've ever received?
Be yourself and don't apologize for it.
I love that. So the bad news is your house caught on fire. Good news is your dog made it out, family, friends, they're all out. What's the one thing you'd grab before you ran out?
I think my computer.
Cool. Good answer. Probably because everything's on there. Maybe an external hard drive.
Pretty much.
Yeah, absolutely. Name one person living or dead that you'd want to have dinner with and why.
You know, I think the Dalai Lama would be awesome. I would expect the conversation to be crap because his English is less than amazing, and my Tibetanese, I don't even know the language he speaks, it would be way atrocious. But my why is I would love to just feel his energy. I would love to feel what it's like to be in his presence. Just be curious about that.
Yeah, I like that answer. At the end of your life, if you could be remembered for only one sentence, what would it be?
JP was someone who advocated and empowered people to find their gifts inside.
I love that. So obviously we're called the Growth Now Movement. So we end every single episode with the same exact question, and that is, in your life, what has been your biggest moment of growth?
What comes to my mind, and I believe it, it'd be interesting, like, oh, here's my answer, and I don't believe it. This is a lie. I can't not say it. When I was 15 was the biggest moment of growth that I, because it spawned so much else, but that so much else wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for this moment when I was 15. So I was going into my sophomore year of high school and I quit the football team. You know, before the season started, I was like, I'm not going back out for football. Now, a little context to that, you know, my freshman year of football, like, I did really well. I got my varsity letter and like, oh, yay, freshman got his varsity letter. And, you know, so I did well and there were a lot of expectations. And like where I, the school I went to, like, you, if you're good at football, like, you don't just quit. Like, that's sacrilegious.
Yeah.
And my mom was very proud of me and started to live through me. Like, her kind of, her social status escalated as my football star status sort of did. So when I like, it was very hard for me to come to the decision to quit football. I let my friends know and they were all supportive. Let the coach know, he was emotionally abusive. And then I let my mom know. And from my experience, my mother disowned me for that summer. When I let her know I'm not going to play football this year, you know, she broke down crying and yelled at me about, how could you be so selfish and how could you do this to me, JP?
Wow.
And it was, I, at the time, I didn't know actually how, I want to say traumatic it was for me. Yet my heart just did not want to play football and my heart wasn't willing to do it for other people. So I honored my heart, even though I had to walk through fire. And there was so much attempt to coerce me from my mom and other people in the community. Like, oh, well, okay, we get it, JP. You want to quit football, but why don't you just play football? So even after I establish I'm not playing, so much coercion trying to get me in. But my willingness to feel the flames of being true to my decision, that gave me so much freaking strength. Learning the lesson was a lot of suffering, and that suffering gave me so much damn strength that I think it works more in my life in such beautiful ways than I can even recognize. So that, man, thank you, 15-year-old JP, for voicing your heart's desire and honoring it, even though you caught hell for it.
And at 15 years old, I mean, that's big. That's really, really tough. Like, that's crazy. But I just thank you so much for sharing that part of your story. And just thank you so much for everything that you're doing in a funny, amazing, meaningful way. And just thank you so much for everything. And thank you for coming on the show. It's been amazing.
Oh, very, you're welcome, brother. Thank you so much for seeing those wonderful things in me. And again, I appreciate you inviting me onto your show.